Hi everyone. Are you tired of feeling overwhelmed by anxiety? From physical symptoms to constant worry, it can be hard to escape the grips of this common mental health issue. But what if I told you that your body has a natural system in place to help reduce anxiety and regulate your stress response? It's called the parasympathetic nervous system, and it's your body's built-in brake to the fight or flight reaction. In today's video, we're going to be exploring the science behind the parasympathetic nervous system, the parts of the brain involved in anxiety, and how you can use them to manage anxiety. But as with anything, there's a catch. So make sure you watch to the end to learn why solely relying on activating the parasympathetic nervous system may not be the answer to your anxiety. But before I get into that, just a couple of disclaimers to go over. I'm a registered psychologist in the province of British Columbia, Canada, and this video is for informational purposes only. It is not intended as a substitute or replacement for advice from your doctor or mental health professional. Now, with those things out of the way, let's start talking about the neurobiology of anxiety. Now, our nervous system consists of two main parts, the parasympathetic nervous system and the sympathetic nervous system. The sympathetic nervous system is like the gas pedal in your car. It's responsible for activating the flight or fight response, which is a survival mechanism that prepares our body to respond to perceived threat or danger. When the sympathetic nervous system is activated, it causes the release of stress hormones like adrenaline and cortisol, which increases our heart rate, blood pressure, and breathing rate. These physiological changes help the body respond quickly and effectively to physical threat. Now, while the fight or flight response is great when you're in a dangerous situation, it's not so great when you're sitting at your desk trying to focus on work. Additionally, prolonged activation of the sympathetic nervous system can have negative effects on your body, such as increased risk of heart disease, high blood pressure, and other health problems. And so that's where the parasympathetic nervous system comes in. It acts as the brake to slow down the fight or flight response and to help you relax. It restores your body to a calm and relaxed state. The parasympathetic nervous system is often referred to as the rest and digest system because it promotes relaxation and facilitates digestion. It slows down heart rate, it slows down breathing rate and blood pressure. It promotes digestion and other restorative processes in your body. The parasympathetic nervous system essentially does the opposite of what the sympathetic nervous system does. Now, for some people with anxiety, they may have an overactive sympathetic nervous system and underactive parasympathetic nervous system, which can lead to heightened or excess physiological responses to stress and anxiety. Essentially, they have a more highly tuned nervous system, kind of like an exotic sports car. So the key is to try and balance the activity of the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems. Now, in order to understand how this works, it's important to understand that one of the key ways that the parasympathetic nervous system helps to counteract the effects of the sympathetic nervous system is through the vagus nerve, which is a long nerve that runs from the brainstem down through the chest and into the abdomen. And when the vagus nerve is activated, it releases a neurotransmitter called acetylcholine, which slows down heart rate and promotes relaxation. And this can help reduce feelings of anxiety and stress and promote a sense of calm. So the vagus nerve plays a critical role in anxiety and regulating the body's response to stress by being activated by the parasympathetic nervous system. So that might lead to the question of how do we turn on this vagus nerve and how do we activate it and thereby activate the parasympathetic nervous system? In order to understand this, we have to go further up the nervous system, into the brain, and understand two key areas of the brain that play a role in managing the parasympathetic nervous system and emotions like anxiety. And we'll start with the amygdala, which is a small almond-shaped structure located deep within the brain's temporal lobe. It's a part of the limbic system, which is involved in processing emotions and memory. And the amygdala plays a key role in processing emotional information, including fear and anxiety. When we perceive a threat or danger, the amygdala sends signals to activate the sympathetic nervous system, leading to that fight or flight response. And in people with anxiety disorders, the amygdala may be overactive, leading to heightened anxiety responses, even in non-threatening situations. Think of the amygdala as your brain's smoke detector. When it senses danger, it sends an alarm signal to activate the fight or flight response. Just like a smoke detector can sometimes be too sensitive and go off even when there's no real threat or danger, an overactive amygdala can trigger anxiety responses even in non-threatening situations. However, research has also shown that another part of the brain, the prefrontal cortex, can modulate activity of the amygdala and help regulate anxiety responses. The prefrontal cortex is the part of the brain located at the front of the skull, just behind the forehead. It's responsible for executive functions like decision-making, impulse control, and working memory. The prefrontal cortex is also involved in regulating emotional responses, including anxiety. And studies have shown that people with anxiety disorders may have reduced activity in the prefrontal cortex, leading to reduced regulation of anxiety responses. You could think of the prefrontal cortex kind of like the CEO of your brain, responsible for making executive decisions and regulating emotional responses. Just like a CEO needs to be able to prioritize and make rational decisions, the prefrontal cortex can modulate the activity of the amygdala and help regulate anxiety responses. So one way to think about this is it's kind of like a seesaw. The amygdala and the prefrontal cortex are on opposite ends of the seesaw, and they need to be in balance for optimal emotion regulation. When the amygdala is overactive, it's like a heavy weight on one end of the seesaw, and so the prefrontal cortex needs to step in and balance things out in order to prevent anxiety from taking over. And this can be done through interventions like cognitive behavioral therapy, which is the type of therapy that I do, which can strengthen the prefrontal cortex's ability to regulate emotion responses. And so overall, the amygdala and the prefrontal cortex play a crucial role in anxiety regulation, with the amygdala sounding off the alarm and the prefrontal cortex acting as the CEO or seesaw balancer to modulate the anxiety responses. So I've talked about the parasympathetic nervous system, the sympathetic nervous system, areas of the brain, and the vagus nerve. I wouldn't blame you if you're feeling a little bit lost understanding how all of these work together. And as I mentioned before, think of the parasympathetic nervous system like the set of brakes on a car. Just as brakes slow down a car's speed, the parasympathetic nervous system helps slow down the body's responses to stress and anxiety. When you're in a stressful situation, like a close call on the highway, your sympathetic nervous system kicks into gear and revs up your body's engine, just like a gas pedal. But once the danger has passed, the parasympathetic nervous system engages and helps put the brakes on your stress response, bringing your body back into a state of rest and relaxation. Now, when it comes to the vagus nerve, it's kind of like the messenger between your brain and your body. It sends signals back and forth, helping your brain stay connected to what's happening in your body. Think of the vagus nerve as a telephone line that connects your brain to different parts of your body. When you're feeling anxious, the vagus nerve can carry signals from the body to the brain, letting the brain know that something is off and that needs attention. And in turn, the brain can use the vagus nerve to send calming signals back to the body, activating the parasympathetic nervous system and slowing down the stress response. To make it even simpler, imagine that you're on a roller coaster. The amygdala is like the part of you that screams when the coaster goes over a steep drop. The prefrontal cortex is like the part of you that can remind yourself that you're safe and that the roller coaster is just a ride. And the vagus nerve is like the part of you that can take deep breaths and calm your body down after the ride is over, bringing your body back into a state of rest and relaxation. So in short, the vagus nerve plays a critical role in regulating anxiety by acting as the messenger between the brain and the body, helping to keep the amygdala and the prefrontal cortex in balance, and activating the parasympathetic nervous system to slow down the stress response. So, if activating the parasympathetic nervous system helps reduce my anxiety, then it seems like the solution for anxiety should just be finding ways to constantly engage the parasympathetic nervous system, and therefore I'll always be calm and relaxed. That makes sense, right? And I see this a lot in some of my clients who've worked with previous therapists or counselors who focus the treatment and interventions solely on things like relaxation training, deep breathing, or meditation. Now, I'm not saying that these aren't helpful tools in terms of managing anxiety, but they're not long-term solutions. Think about our metaphor of the parasympathetic nervous system as the brake pedal in your car that slows you down. If you're driving too fast, it makes sense that you need to activate the brake pedal to slow down and be safe. But if you're constantly stepping on the brake pedal, what's going to happen? You might come to a complete stop and feel completely stuck. By simply stimulating the parasympathetic nervous system through relaxation techniques, deep breathing, and meditation, this only provides temporary relief from the anxiety symptoms. It's like putting a Band-Aid on a wound without addressing the underlying cause. While a Band-Aid may provide some temporary relief, it's not fixing the root cause of the problem. And I see this so often, particularly in the treatment of generalized anxiety disorder or panic disorder, where the therapy sessions focus so much on trying to calm and relax the person that it's actually counterproductive, because the focus is on reducing the physical symptoms of anxiety rather than what's causing the physical symptoms of anxiety in the first place, which is excessive worry in the case of generalized anxiety disorder and the fear of physical sensations of anxiety in panic disorder. If the only intervention is to try to activate the parasympathetic nervous system so that the person can feel more temporarily calm and relaxed, this is actually counterproductive because it's not getting at the actual problem. Also, if you have to constantly be doing deep breathing, meditation, or relaxation techniques like progressive muscle relaxation, it's going to make you less efficient getting anything else done in your life because you're constantly having to meditate or do progressive muscle relaxation or do breathing exercises. So that's one of the main reasons why I don't spend a lot of time focusing on relaxation techniques when working with my therapy clients. Well, for one, there are lots of resources and YouTube videos that a person can watch that go through how to do the various different types of relaxation training. But more importantly, my focus when working with clients is to address the factors that are maintaining the person's anxiety symptoms, essentially dealing with the underlying anxiety condition that's causing their sympathetic nervous system to be so activated. And this is how cognitive behavioral therapy works to reduce anxiety, by helping a person develop a new understanding of their anxiety and equipping them with tools to help change behavior patterns and thinking patterns that are causing the underlying anxiety in the first place. So you can think of relaxation techniques like deep breathing, similar to a person driving, taking their foot off the gas pedal, and gently tapping the brake pedal. Deep breathing slows down your breathing rate, which in turn helps to slow down your heart rate and reduce activation of the sympathetic nervous system. The vagus nerve acts as the brake to slow down the body's responses to stress and anxiety and affects activity of the amygdala. Cognitive behavioral therapy activates the parasympathetic nervous system in a different way. It aims at helping a person change their behaviors and reframe negative thoughts that are contributing to their anxiety, focusing more on the role of the prefrontal cortex. Using our driving metaphor, imagine a driver who always sees the worst in every situation and assumes the worst possible outcome when they're driving. This driver is likely to be anxious and always on edge. Cognitive behavioral therapy can teach the driver to reframe their thoughts and to see things from a more realistic and reasonable perspective. And this is like replacing the lead foot on the gas pedal with a lighter, more controlled foot, which results in a much more natural way of activating the vagus nerve and parasympathetic nervous system. If you want to learn more about how cognitive behavioral therapy works, I'd encourage you to check out this video. So that's all for today's video. As always, thank you for making it all the way to the end of this video, and I will see you in the next one.